me get down to Scott Brown. He's a Bloomberg Best on Jobs, a chief economist for Raymond James, joining us on this. And Scott, I know you actually were expecting a lower number than the survey. I think 40,000 was your print. What do you make of this?
Well, certainly it's better than the consensus was looking for. It's also much, much better than the market had feared. Some people were talking about a possibility of even a negative number here. One thing we should tell listeners is that you know, these numbers aren't reported with all that much accuracy. It's plus or minus 100,000. So that's a pretty wide range. So it's always going to be a little bit of a, you know, bond market bingo. But in any case, it looks like the stock market's going to win today with these numbers. The bigger picture, though, is still a concern. So, you know, we may take some time to digest these numbers, but then people are going to get back to looking at the overall economy, the situation in Europe, and that's pretty unpleasant at this point.
It is. I mean, you know, we are still to moderate this, looking at 117,000 jobs created. Scott, just hang on. Let me bring in Leo Hindery again, who's staying with us through this hour. And Leo, you know, of course, you've been quite bearish about what's going on in the jobs market. If you had a reason to buy today, you would buy today on this number. But other than that, as Scott was saying, the overall picture is still bleak.
Yeah, I mean, I think Scott was very right on. Don't measure anything on a bump in a single market. You got to remember the expectation was for 85,000. Mm-hmm. That's roughly about 40% of what we need just to stay even. We came in at 117,000. We're roughly half now of what we need to stay even. So we didn't stay even in the month of July. When we do real unemployment numbers here later this morning,
right,
we're going to find actually that it got worse again. And that's the point that Scott is making. And I said it in the earlier segment. When all the markets move in consort, a message is coming across. When we move just because of our time zone against an expectation, nothing changed structurally today. Mm. 85,000 or 117,000, we have 154 million women and men in the American workforce. A few thousand here or there doesn't address the 29.5 million of them.
Right.
29.5 million, as Scott can confirm, who in real terms are unemployed. That's a breathtaking number. I've run some pretty large companies in my career. It's inconceivable how you create 29.5 million new jobs without a lot more support from this government.
And in fact, a lot of the CEOs for their companies, major companies, are now pulling back on hiring.
They are, and we've seen some announcements even this week. Mm-hmm. And we're always about a month out of cycle. And we were certainly depressed in June, but I was depressed because it didn't come close to what we need to stay even.
Right.
And it didn't dip into the bucket of the unemployed. I say the same thing today.
But, you know, the recession, the R word, I mean, how does this jobs report, you know, change anything in your view about whether or not we're going to slip into that?
Well, I think as with most of the economic data that we've been getting over the last several weeks, this report suggests an economy that is still growing. So we're not in a recession, but one that is definitely subpar. You know, you look at the first half of the year, and I think one of the major factors was this increase in gasoline prices. We went from $3 at the start of the year to $4 in early May. And as such, that just wiped out all the positive effects of job growth, wage growth, and the cut in payroll taxes that we saw. Gasoline prices have started to come down a lot in the last couple days. That'll be a little bit of a plus, I think, for the consumer in the second half of the year. And if we were to see gasoline falling even further, if we get down to maybe $3 a gallon, I think that would be a big, big plus for the overall outlook. But again, I think the bottom line is that we're not really seeing any signs that we're in a recession just yet.
You know, you and I were just talking in this break, right? I mean, you've run several major
right.
public companies, you know, TCI, AT&T Broadband, and others. If you were still running one of those public companies today, what would be going through your mind as you're watching this?
Well, I would have had, after last evening, roughly the same apprehension that these women and men behind us had, which is, where is consumer confidence? The only thing that's ever mattered to the U.S. economy is a vibrant middle class that grows from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. And we don't have that right now.
Well, who you're going to sell to, essentially.
That's who you're going to sell to. And we saw in June, which is the last month for which we had purchasing, that it's the lowest it's been since early 2008. So as your colleagues referred to this morning, this is a better jobs number than we expected, but we expected a very poor one.
Right.
So this is slightly less poor. Where is the confidence? So as a CEO, I've never hired a woman or man based on a tax credit. I've never hired them based on repatriated earnings. I do it when I'm confident that my business is going to grow. And 90 plus percent of the U.S. economy on the industrial side is consumer confidence. Mm. When these women and men and families are buying things because they have disposable income, we all rise. And what's unfortunate about the numbers, we've had a few minutes now, Betty, to dig down into them.
Right.
Manufacturing in this country is about 9% of the workforce, 154 million women and men, 9% of whom are in manufacturing. Germany, by contrast, has 25%, three times that number. So it just snapped back from the Great Recession. And China is certainly trying to build its manufacturing numbers to a disproportionate
higher and
level.
Higher, right.
So we're stuck here. And there truly are, as your colleagues referred to an earlier comment I made as well, there's two and a half economies that are going to drive this world economy back to prosperity. Germany, which is now the banker of Europe, us, and China.
So, Leo, you're saying that if we had more manufacturing jobs, we'd be able to bounce out of this recession faster?
Oh, absolutely. And the reason is because you just look back in our families' histories, our respective families' histories. Service industries came to the fore, whether it was fast foods or nail salons or beauty parlors, you name it, resorts, whatever, when we had a stability of income coming out of the Second World War, and we knew that we had this manufacturing base under us of roughly 25-30% of our employees. Mm-hmm. That fell beginning in the Reagan administration. It now sits at 8 or 9%.
Okay.
No country as large as ours, Betty, can survive into the long term short of bubbles, these credit bubbles, with only 8 or 9% of women and men making something.
Mm. And I know that is one of the key tenets,
yes,
as you've talked about with job creation. Leo, thank you so much for joining me here on the floor
My real pleasure.
Of the New York Stock Exchange. Great to have Leo with